The 1997 Canadian Open Mathematics Challenge, Part A. In triangle ABC, angle A equals 120 degrees. A point D is inside the triangle such that angle DBC is 2 times angle ABD, and angle DCB is 2 times angle ACD. Determine the measure in degrees of angle BDC. Okay, since this diagram is at the heart of the question, let's just focus on it. So based on what the question told me, I can label this theta, this 2 theta. I can label this anything really, alpha, and this is 2 alpha. And then this, they have told me, if I remember, is 120 degrees, this angle A. So that's all I've done. I've just really just use the question stem to label it. Now we know that all the angles of a triangle always add up to 180. So let's do that. Let's add them all up. So these guys, that's 3 theta. These two, it's 3 alpha. And this guy up here is 120. So that means that 3 theta plus 3 alpha would be 60. And if you divide through by 3, you get alpha plus theta is equal to 20. Okay, great. So that takes care of the first part. Now we have to try to figure out the angle BDC. Angle BDC is what we have to calculate in this question. So BDC is this guy right here, this angle. Okay, well, we'll just use this triangle now. This triangle right here and its degrees. So angle BDC plus 2 theta, right, this part. And then this part, which is 2 alpha, and that equals 180. So that means BDC plus 2, put it in brackets, alpha plus theta is 180, correct? And then we know that alpha plus theta is 20. So I just put that substitution in there, and that's it. And we can solve for this. So angle BDC looks to me like it's 180 minus 40. And of course, that is 140 degrees. Solve the following system of equations. Well, we have to do some manipulation here. And lots of ways to proceed, but let's just do it in probably a simple way that should be sufficient. So we have from this guy here, I'm just going to put x in terms of y, 10 to the power of 8 over y squared. Okay. And then what I'll do is I'll substitute that into here. So it's x to the power of 3 over y is equal to 10 to the power of 10. Well, x is this. So I'll just put that where x is. So 10 to the power of 8 over y squared, all to the power of 3. Over y is 10 to the power of 10, correct? All right, so carefully without making any algebraic mistakes, this is gonna be 10 to the power of 24 over y to the power of 6, and I'll just bring this 1 over y over like that, 10 to the power of 10. Okay, let's see here. So we got 10 to the power of 24 over y to the power of 7 is 10 to the power of 10. I'll bring the y to the power of 7 on this side and the 10 to the power of 10 down here, like that. And then that looks like 10 to the power of 14 is y to the power of 7. Okay, great. Let's see. Take everything to the 1 over 7th power, like that. And that will allow me to just have y on this side, and this will be just 10 squared. So there you go. I just got y, and I have to figure out x, and what was x? X was, oh, here's x. X was 10 to the power of 8 over y squared. Well, y is 10 squared, so 10 squared all squared, like that. So that looks like 10 to the power of 8 over 10 to the power of 4. So x is 10 to the power of 4. So my xy is 10 to the power of 4 and 10 to the power of 2. There you go. Determine all points on the straight line which joins negative 4, 11 to 16, negative 1, and whose coordinates are positive integers. So, the first thing, of course, is probably just to draw a little diagram. And it doesn't have to be super accurate, right? We're just trying to get a little understanding of what this question is. So, negative 4, 11, let's just say it's about here, right there. Negative 4, I put 11 up here. This is, of course, the y-axis. This is, of course, the x-axis. 16, negative 1. 16 is going to be way out here somewhere. And negative 1 is approximately here, negative 1. So we got a point right here. And then we just have to connect those, really. That's it. And once you connect them, we'll get somewhat of an idea of this line. It's sort of like that, right? Something like this. Okay, great. So now where do we proceed from here? What do they want? They want all the points on this line whose coordinates are positive integers. Okay. So I think the first step, of course, is to figure out the equation of that line. That shouldn't be a problem. Equation of any line is y is equal to mx plus b, where m is the slope. The slope is calculated by rise over run. Rise would be the difference of the y-coordinate. So in this case, these are our two points. So 11 minus minus 1. Run is the difference of the x-coordinate, so minus 4 minus 16. So this is 12 over minus 20, which in lowest terms is negative 3 over 5. Okay, so that means my equation is y is equal to minus 3 over 5x plus b. To get b, I'll just substitute one of these. Either one is fine. So you take your pick. I'll just put in the first one. So that means when y is 11, x is negative 4. And then this looks like it will be 11 is equal to 12 over 5 plus b. So b is equal to 11 minus 12 over 5. And that means b is equal to 43 over 5. So my equation is y is equal to minus 3 over 5x plus 43 over 5. All right. You can also put this into a format that makes it a little bit easier to understand. 43 minus 3x over 5. Now, basically, the question boils down to finding integer solutions to this equation. So if you make a little table, x and y, we have to start finding positive integer solutions. Okay? Well, the first positive integer is 1, so let's just see what happens with 1 when x is 1. When x is 1, y is 8. Okay, great. We got one solution. Then you can do this, you know, for x equals 2, x equals 3, and so on. But you'll quickly figure out that this top has to be divisible by 5. That's the only way that y will be an integer. And that will happen. You'll be able to figure out very quickly when this top is sort of like a multiple of 5, right? So, for example, 40 was a multiple of 5. That's why we got an integer. So the next time you get a multiple of 5 is when x is 6. It would be 43 minus 18, which is 25, and 25 divided by 5 is 5. The next time you get an integer is when x is 11, that's 2. And then after that, these start to become negative, and those are no good. Even though if they're integers, they're no good because our question wants positive integers. So these are the only three. So these are the solutions to the question. Given three distinct digits, A, B, and C, it is possible by choosing two digits at a time to form six two-digit numbers. Determine all possible sets, A, B, C, for which the sum of the six two-digit numbers is 484. Our numbers are A, B, and C. These are digits, and they have to be distinct, and this is important. We'll come back to that later. So we form two-digit numbers? Well, one could be AB, another could be AC. One could be BA, another one could be BC. Another one could be CA, and another one could be CB. And now they're saying the sum of these guys, if you add all these, is 484. Okay, well that means that AB plus AC plus BA, all that stuff is 484. But you got to be careful because you have to write it in the proper way. Let me explain. Let's say you have a number 47. What is 47 if you were to write it out? It's actually 4 times 10 plus 7. It's not 4 plus 7, correct? Obviously, 4 plus 7 is 11. But 4 times 10 is 40 plus 7. That is indeed 47. That's the correct way of writing it. So same thing. If I write AB, it would be A times 10 plus B. It's not A plus B. It's not A plus B, right? Because this is the tens digit. So when you add all these guys up, it becomes A times 10 plus B plus A times 10 plus C, and so on, right? Plus B times 10 plus A plus B times 10 plus C times 10 plus A plus C times 10 plus B. And all of that is equal to 484. Adding all these up, if you get like terms, you will get, let's see here, 10A, 10A, that's 20A, and then we got an A and A, so 22A. And very similarly, you're going to get 22B and 22C. Now divide through by 22, and it divides very nicely. 484 divided by 22 is 22. Okay, so we have boiled it down to this. We need three digits that basically add up to 22. Okay, that doesn't seem like it should be that hard. But here's the thing, they've got to be distinct. That's a very key word in the question that should not be missed. Okay, let's see what we can do here. A, B, and C, let's make a table, and off we go. And I'm going to write distinct with a question mark, yes or no, and A plus B plus C over here. And it has to be 22, but let's see if it is. Okay, let's start off with 0. 0 is our first digit, right? Our digits are going to be anywhere from 0 to 9, so let's just start off with 0. If A is 0, that means B plus C would have to be 22, and that's impossible because even if they're both 9, which is the largest, this would be 18. So the only time this is ever going to work is if you get A up to 4. Then if they're 9 and 9, you'll get 22. A equals 1 and 2 won't work. But are they distinct? And the answer is no, because these are the same. See what I mean? Okay, let's keep going here. Let's try A equals 5. Then you can have a 9 and an 8, and that will work. Are they distinct? Yeah. So this is a good one. This one, I will keep this one. I'm pretty confident that's one of the ones that works and meets our criteria that A plus B plus C has to equal 22, and the three digits have to be distinct. Let's go to A equals 6. 9 and 7. Does this equal 22? Yes. Is it distinct? Yes, it is. Okay, so we got another one. Great. A equals 7. When A is 7, actually, let's go back here. With 6, you can get another one, 8 and 8. The only problem with this is that the digits are not distinct, so that's no good. But I wanted to include that just to kind of show you. Okay, let's move over to A equals 7. Then 9 and 6, that will work. 22, and are they distinct? Are they distinct? Yeah, they are. Okay, so I found another one. But here's the thing. This one is pretty much the same as this one, right? 7, 9, 6, 7, 9, 6. What I mean by that is the same 3. So we can just get that by doing different combinations of this one here. So that's not a unique one, so I'm not going to get too excited about that. And then when you keep going here, you'll find you'll just get either the same ones or something that isn't distinct. So for example, if you make A equals 8, and then you make this, say, 9 and 5, 8, 9, and 5 is already up here. See what I mean? So, and the same thing with A equals 9. You'll get 9 and 4, but then it's no longer distinct. So these are the only two. And from those two, each of them will give 6, right? So for the first one, you have 5, 9, and 8. But you can have 6 possible combinations. You can have 5, 8, 9. You can have 9, 5, 8. You can have 9, 8, 5. You can have 8, 5, 9. You can have 8, 9, 5. Correct? So this guy right here produces these 6. And in a very similar way, you can show that this also produces 6. Now, 6, 9, 7, 6, 7, 9, 9, 6, 7, 9, 7, 6, 7, 6, 9, and 7, 9, 6. So these 6 are also produced. So in total, we have 6 and 6, so we have 12. So we have 12 different possible sets, I guess. So there you go. Two cubes have their faces painted either red or blue. The first cube has 5 red faces and 1 blue face. When the two cubes are rolled simultaneously, the probability that the two top faces show the same color is 1/2. How many red faces are there on the second cube? So we've got, red is probably not a good color. Let's try just putting black. I don't want to get you confused. So we got two cubes, right? And they're saying that on the first cube, you have 5 red faces and 1 blue face. Okay, great. On the second, we don't know. We have a certain number of red faces and a certain number of blue faces. Now, I don't know, so I'm going to say there's A red faces and B blue faces. So for whatever A is, whatever number it is, A could be either whatever, right? 0 to 6. You could have either 0 red faces or 1 red face all the way up to 6 red faces. And B is obviously a number from 0 to 6. But one thing we know for sure is that A plus B has to equal 6, right? All the faces combined have to be 6 because a cube has 6 faces. Just like here, 5 plus 1 is equal to 6. Okay, from here we can easily get that B is therefore equal to 6 minus A. Okay. Now before I jump into this cube, I want to explain it in this cube. If I asked you, what is the probability if I roll this that I'm going to get a red face that comes up on the top? Well, that's easy. 5 over 6. Is the probability that I'll get a red. What if I said, what's the probability of me getting a blue face if I roll the dice, the blue face on the top? Well, that's 1 over 6, right? That's pretty much all there is to that. So now let's talk about this guy here. They're saying that when you roll both of these guys, two cubes roll simultaneously, the probability that the top two faces show the same color. Okay. So same color means either they're both red or they're both blue. Let's talk about both red. The probability that this is red, I actually already did it, it's 5 over 6. The probability that this guy shows up red, you can do that, I'm sure, in your head, A over 6. Correct? Whatever A is, you'd put that in the numerator. It's over 6. And then these two guys have to be multiplied, because both of those have to happen, this and that. Okay, so that looks like 5A over 36. Both B. Now that you're an expert, I'm sure you could do this. Probability that this guy shows up a B is 1 over 6. Probability that this one shows up as a B is B over 6, correct? And then you have to multiply these guys. But I want everything in terms of A, and I can do that since I know that B is equal to 6 minus A. And therefore, this looks like 6 minus A over 36. Okay. But we want both. We want this scenario or this scenario, right? It could be either. So in a probability question, when it's this or that, you have to add. So you have to add this and this. So let's do that. So we want 5a over 36 plus 6 minus a over 36. Because remember, the plus sign represents an or. Multiplication is and in probability questions. If I want this and that, you multiply. If I want this or that, you add. And they've told you that this probability is a half. They've given you the answer. So now we just have to solve for a. Okay, I think I can do that. This looks like 4a plus 6 is equal to 1 over 2, and that's over 36. Cross multiply and I get 36 is equal to 8a plus 12. And that means 24 is equal to 8a, and that means a is equal to 3. And what do they want? How many red faces? I think I got it, right? That means this a is 3. So a is 3, 3 red faces. The triangle ABC has sides AB equal 137, AC is 241, BC is 200. There is a point D on BC such that both in circles of triangles ABD and ACD touch AD at the same point E. Determine the length of CD. Well, we're going to have to do some labeling here. So let's see if I can label this. First, I'll draw a line from the center till there and from the center till there. These are tangent points, so they're going to be right angles right there. And very similarly, from this center to here and that center to there, those are tangent points, so they will be also. And then one line that goes from this center to that center like that. Okay. And then let's start labeling these. I'll call this A from here to here. Now, I hope you know there's a rule that if you have a point and from it, if you draw a line to the tangent and then draw a line from that same point to another tangent, those two lines will be the same. So this will also be A in terms of its length. In a very similar way, if this is B, this length is also B. And in a very similar way, this will be the same as that, but I haven't labeled it yet. So they told me in the question that this whole side is 137 and that this side is 241 and that this side is 200. So that means that this segment from there to there is 200 minus A minus B. This segment here is 137 minus A. And this segment here is 241 minus B. Well, we know that this segment from here to here will be the same as this one, right? Because they're both going to tangent points. So that means that this guy in the middle from A to E is 137 minus A. So I'll just write that in here. Avoid making the diagram messy. Now, by the same principle, this segment, which is from point A to a tangent point, will be equivalent to this segment, which is from point A to a tangent point. So that means AE is also equivalent to 241 minus B. Well, we can set those equal to each other. So 137 minus A is equal to 241 minus B. And that means B is equal to 104 plus A. Okay, great. And then where do we proceed from here? All right, well, I think we're getting somewhere here. This segment from here to here, I will just call M, and from here to here, I will just call N. Now, by the same sort of principle, that is also M and is also N. Right, because they're both tangent points that emanate from D. So just like how I did up here, I've shown that D to E is equal to M. I also showed that D to E is equal to N. So that means that M is equal to N. Okay, great. Now let's concentrate on the full length from B to C. All the way from B to C is A plus M plus N plus B, and that is equal to 200 according to the question. Well, we know that A and B have a relationship right there, so I can substitute that in. A is just A, and then B is 104 plus A. And then the M and N are equal, so I can put M, and then I just put M again. Okay, add this all up, and we get 2A plus 2M is equal to 96 when I bring the 104 over. So divide through by 2, and you get A plus M is equal to 48. Great. I think we're almost done here. We have to figure out CD. Well, CD is equal to the whole length, BC, minus BD, correct? Well, BC is 200, and BD is the distance from here to here, which is A plus M, which we just figured out was 48. And there we go. That gives you 152 for the value of CD, and we're done. Determine the minimum value of f at x, where f at x is this big long equation. Okay, well, the first thing, of course, we have to expand this guy out. And let's do it carefully. 9 sine squared x plus 12 sine x cos x minus 30 sine x minus 12 sine x cos x minus 16 cos squared x plus 40 cos x minus 30 sine x minus 40 cos x plus 100. Okay, great. Now at this point, let's see what we can do. Collect like terms. Hopefully some of this stuff cancels. I think this cancels with that, which is great. And I think this cancels with that, and I think that's about as far as we can get. So 9 sine squared x minus 60 sine x, right, when you're combining this with this, and then minus 16 cos squared x plus 100. Okay, great. Now we use our famous identity that sine squared x plus cos squared x is equal to 1, probably the most well-known trig identity. And we'll use that and sub it into here because I want everything in terms of just one trigonometry entity, which I will choose in this case sine. So sine squared x, these two will remain the same. But then for cos squared x, I'll put in the equivalent, which is 1 minus sine squared x. All right, moving right along. So expand this out again. 9 sine squared x minus 60 sine x minus 16 plus 16 sine squared x plus 100. Collecting like terms, we get 25 sine squared x minus 60 sine x plus 84. Okay, now we have to complete the square. That's the key to this question. Complete the square. And when you do, it will give me the minimum value. If this was a graph, I have no idea what it looks like, but let's just say it looks like this. When you complete the square, you'll be able to get the minimum value. So whatever that minimum value is, that's what completing the square allows you to do. So how do we complete the square? The first thing, of course, we have to factor out this coefficient right here. So sine squared x minus 60 over 25 sine x. And then the 84, you just leave it alone out here like that. Now, how do you complete the square? Well, you have to take this coefficient, take half of it, and then square it. Okay, so that coefficient, I'm gonna, it makes it a little bit easier for me to put it into decimals, so that's what I'm gonna do. So 60 over 25 is actually equivalent to 2.4. So that's what I'm gonna do that right there. And then the 2.4, we have to take, remember, half of that and then square it. Half of negative 2.4 is negative 1.2. And then if you square it, it becomes positive 1.44. So that's what you have to add, 1.44. And then, of course, immediately you have to subtract it because you can't just change an equation like that. So this is the process of completing the square. Now something nice happens is that these first three terms will be able to be factored nicely. And in this case, it becomes sine x minus this guy right here. Or you're just adding it, really. So minus 1.2, really, all squared. And then be careful, when you kick this guy out of the bracket, you have to multiply by 25. So this becomes minus 36. And then this guy is the same. So completing the square is not really that difficult. If you practice several of these, you'll be able to get it for any such equation. Okay, so now let's just add up the last two guys. This is going to be just 1.2 all squared, and this is 48. Yeah. Okay. So that means that when sine of x is equal to 1.2, this thing vanishes and you're left with 48. And therefore 48 is the minimum. Now, is what I said correct? Not really, because the sine of x can never be 1.2. Because if you remember the sine graph, if I remember the sine graph, it oscillates between 1 and negative 1, right? So the most sine of x can ever be is 1, so it can never be 1.2. Okay, well, what do I do then? Well, I'm trying to minimize. I'm trying to get the minimum value. And the minimum value will be obtained. When we make this as small as possible, right? That's what minimum means. Well, if I put sine of x between 1 and negative 1, which is what it always is, what value of sine x do I put here to make this minimum? Well, I fiddle around a bit. If I put, say, negative 1, it becomes negative 1 minus 1.2 all squared, and that's going to be, I don't know, something. It's going to be a pretty big number, I think. Negative 1 minus 1.2, and then times it by 2.2. It'll be like 4.8, so that's kind of big. I don't think I want that. How about 0? If I put 0 for sine x, this will be 1.2 squared, which is 1.44. Okay, a little bit better. How about if I put 1? If I put 1 for sine x, 1 minus 1.2 is negative 0.2. And that's about as small as I can get it. That's about as small as I can get this guy in here. And that's what I'll do. So I'll let sine of x equal 1. That's where I'm going to get my minimum value. And if I do, I get 25, 1 minus 1.2, all squared. And then let's see here. 1 minus 1.2, 1 minus 1.2 is negative 0.2. Negative 0.2 squared is 0.04. And then, of course, I've got to multiply it by 25, and that's 1. And then this is 49. There you go. 49 is the answer. So it wasn't a completely straightforward question, because this is a little tricky right here, since you cannot have a sine x of 1.2. I think some people might have said, oh yeah, 48 is the answer, and that's it. They've ended the question. So you got to think a little bit further here. But in any case, the answer is 49. An hourglass is formed from two identical cones Initially, the upper cone is filled with sand and the lower cone is empty. The sand flows at constant rate from the upper to the lower cone. It takes exactly 1 hour to empty the upper cone. How long does it take for the cone, for the depth of sand in the lower cone to be half the depth of sand in the upper cone? Assume that the sand stays level in both cones at the same time. All right, let's make a very basic diagram. I don't want to make this too confusing. So here's a cone that's sitting upside down, right? Here's a cone, right? And then we got another cone that's the exact same, but it's on the bottom. Now, initially, the first cone is filled with sand, right? It's all sand. Now, before I proceed with the question, I want to ask you a question that if all the sand takes 1 hour, so all the sand takes 1 hour to empty, and if I asked you, if half the volume of the sand is to be emptied, how long does it take? Half of the sand. How long does it take to empty? Well, 30 minutes, right? Half the amount of time. I hope that makes sense. So what we have to do is figure out the volume of what they're asking for. What they're saying is that if you have a scenario, let's draw this again, where you've got these two identical cones, right? And the sand flows. How long does it take for the depth of sand in the lower cone to be half the depth of sand in the upper cone? So that means that if you make this top to bottom, the depth is going to be here. And the depth up here is going to be approximately here. So let me explain what happened here. Sand continued to flow from the top to the bottom. And there's no more sand in here. That's why that's empty. Where did that sand go? Well, collected down here. I'm assuming there's a little hole somewhere in this circle that allows sand to flow. And then once the sand is in there, this depth right here, we'll just call it whatever you want to call it, small h, let's say, is half this depth right here. So if that depth is big H, basically what it means is that big H is equal to 2 small h. Correct? That's what the question basically is saying. How long does it take for the depth of sand in the lower cone to be half the depth of the sand in the upper cone? All right, great. So now what we have to do is use that fact to figure out the volume. The volume of this guy right here. That sand, what is the volume of that sand compared to the full volume? And then that will allow us to figure out the time. Okay, so now we have to use similar triangles. This triangle right here, that's what I'm going to use. So I'll just draw that over here on the side, like that, like this. I basically just drawn this triangle over on that side. Okay, well, let's label this. I'll try not to make it too confusing here. You can use whatever variables you want. It doesn't really matter, right? So I'll just call this small r for radius, big R for radius, and then this guy from here to here I'll call small d, and top to bottom I'll call big D. Okay, using similar triangles, it's pretty straightforward. We can tell that this small d over small r is the same as big D over big R. Okay, and therefore big D, which is top to bottom, we know for a fact that's equivalent to 3 of the small d's, right? Because from here to here, which is from here to here, which we call h, we said was 2 h's, right? This guy right here. So this d right here is the same as this guy down here. It's basically just that sand placed down there. So D is basically the same as this, correct? So that's basically the same as H, pretty much. And then we know that H is equivalent to half of this big H, correct? Or the other way of saying it, which is what I wrote here, is that H is equal to 2 small h. So this is just 2 small h. No problem. And then this guy up here, just that from there to there, was 1 small h, because it's the same as this down here. And therefore, this whole thing, top to bottom, is h plus 2h, which is 3h. So this whole thing, top to bottom, which we call D, is just 3H. And then D, which I had called from here to here, right there, is the same as this guy down here, which is small h. And then this R, and then this R. Okay, so hopefully that wasn't too confusing. You can use whatever variables you want. Okay. So this just becomes, the H's cancel, so this becomes 1 over R is equal to 3 over big R. So that means that R, if you cross multiply, is equal to 3 small r. Okay, or you can write that small r is equal to big R over 3. Okay. Now, similarly, we have to compare the heights. This compares the radius of that circle in the middle. We have to now compare the heights. Well, the heights we can easily compare. The full height from top to bottom, right, that height right there, is, well, I call it D, right? So that's that. And then the little guy, which is from here to here, we had just called small d, right, right there. But we know that small d compared to big D is going to be from here to here, which is small d, and then from here to here, which is equal to 2h, but h is the same as d, right? Small h is the same as small d, so 2h is equal to 2d. So d plus 2d, so therefore d is equal to 3d. Or you can write that d over 3 is equal to small d. So there we go. Those two pieces of information are really all we need. Now we have to figure out the volume. Well, the volume of all the sand is really the volume of a cone, which is 1/3 pi r squared times height. This is the full volume of all the sand. Now we have to figure out just the sand, the volume of sand in that little segment there, okay? Well, that shouldn't be hard because we know the dimensions. It's small r, correct? And small h, this guy right here. So that volume will be 1/3 pi small r squared times small h. Well, small r is equivalent to big R over 3. Don't forget to square it. And then small h, we use this one because we have that D is the same as H. So this is really like saying that H over 3 is the same as small h, like that. Like I said, whatever variables you want to use. So this is really H over 3. So this becomes 1/3 R squared over 9 times H over 3. And that looks like, to me, 1/3 r squared h times 1 over 27, right? Now, this right here is the same as this, 1/3 pi, or I forgot a pi in there. The pi, don't forget the pi. I'll just put the pi up there. So that means that this guy here is the volume of the full, right? It's exactly the same as what we have over here. So we can say the volume of sand is 1 over 27 times the full volume, this sand right here. So that means that if it takes 1 hour to empty the total sand, it would, which is 60 minutes, it would take 1 over 27 times 60 minutes to empty the small segment of sand right here. And whatever that works out to, 60 over 27 hours, you can just say. That should be sufficient. And I think that works out to about 2 minutes and 13 seconds. And there you go.